Hi guys, I'm Sugandha and today we are diving deep into the topic that I know is on the minds of many international students. How to find part-time job in Ireland and whether you're looking to gain some work experience or earn some extra money, this video is for you. I'm super excited because joining me today is Arunima, who is also a student in Dublin City University. And Arunima will be sharing her personal experience of navigating the part-time job market here. And today we'll be covering a variety of topics such as where to find jobs, how to create a strong CV, how to ace in your interview, and many more tips and suggestions. So stay tuned. And also, if you see a lot of dog hair while we are talking, just please don't mind because we have a very cute Labrador with us. he's just chilling right now. We're just dog sitting him today. So yeah, let's get started with the video. So Arunima, please introduce yourself and help us understand the Irish part-time job market for students.
Okay. So hi guys, I'm Arunima. I'm currently pursuing a course in my master's in political communication, almost done with it. And I arrived in Ireland in September 23. At the outset, I should mention that for me, finding a part-time job was quintessential. It wasn't just to kind of support my fun lifestyle. It was literally necessary for me to find a job, otherwise there was no way I could have stayed in Ireland. So yeah, the desperation to find it was there for sure. Of course, I'm assuming that if you're looking into it, you already have your documentation in place, because the two main documents that you need are, first of all, is your PPSN, and the second one that you need is your IRP. To be honest, a lot of people, like, there's some certain jobs that are okay with waiting for your IRP, but PPSN is very important. But the one I landed with, my first part-time job, they in fact were okay with not having my PPSN because your 40% tax gets deducted till you get the PPSN, but they wanted my IRP. So I had to wait for my IRP for a bit longer. So yeah. So first of all, when I, there's like a plethora of options that you could go for. There are many types of jobs that you can take up. There's a lot of, the very common option is going for retail. You know, you go and you kind of, which will, or you will often see the job title as sales assistant, maybe mostly that's what it's called. And you kind of, whether it's shops like Penny's or H&M, or even in retail shops like pharmacy shops, especially if you have like a science background, that especially helps. So there's a lot of retail options that you can go into. These are the big chains, but there also, you might find that wherever you take up residence, there will be smaller chains. And my top tip is that, you know, always try to find jobs at the smaller independent chains or independent stores, which are near where you live, because you can actually personally speak to them, hand over your CV and your other details, and it'll be easier. There's retail, there's also things like, of course, fast food chains like McDonald's, Burger King. They're very popular with students as well. Spar. Spar is a chain of like groceries and stuff, and a lot of people take up jobs there. Then there's also a very popular choice is the healthcare assistant jobs. I should say it's a very tough job, but it's very well paying, and there's even the option of getting a few extra hours because there's a serious dearth of workers here. And it's a very well-paying job because usually you get like the minimum wage, which currently is 12.80 per hour, but the healthcare assistants get like a little better pay. There's also something that I landed up with, and there's this very popular sales job, which is the door-to-door fundraising. You could either get involved with the charity, like I got involved with Oxfam. You could get involved with other charities like Bernardo's, maybe a Concern, which is very popular in Ireland. Or other charities if you're interested, or you could get involved with companies and you basically go door to door, and it's a salesman job, but it's quite tough, but it's again very well paying and it's quite fun if you have a good team. So these are the bigger, like the major options. Of course, you could land up with other things.
What about the security job? Is also very popular during the consul season, especially in summer.
Consul students, yeah. So I also took up stewardship jobs. I have separate struggles. Of course, I ended up doing a lot of part-time jobs for some reason because, yeah, stability has not been a part of my life. But steward jobs, yeah, you don't need any specific license. And there are two very famous companies in Ireland. One is Sports Security and one is Eventsec. Eventsec is actually a Northern Ireland company, but they also have a very good, they have a lot of options. But there's also one very popular option with students, and that's the PSI license, basic license job. You pay about 350 euros, I think, and it goes up to, I think, 550 euros where you get different kind of licenses together. It's a one-time investment. I know it sounds quite a bit because it's almost an investment of INR 35,000 to 45,000.
Yeah.
But believe me, if you are patient enough and if you have the resources, obviously, you earn it back very quickly because it's a very stable job. There's always going to be a demand for it. So the fear of being laid off is very low if you have the security license. If you can wait for 2-3 months, because the course is just a 7-day online course, but the license takes about 2-3 months to come. And if you just want to like chill and not have a very demanding job, I think security is not bad. So PSI license, you can even look into that. And I think there are some tutoring options also people take up. I personally don't have any experience with it. But if you think that you have an exceptional background in any particular subject, especially if you come from a finance or a science background, or if you're into, if you have very good knowledge of Adobe, mm-hmm. Or any editing jobs, there are wonderful jobs out there. The best part is they're well paid. And again, they're very flexible. So you can work it around, especially if you're pursuing a course where there are too many classes, having flexible hours is very helpful.
And what is the range of the pay for part-time jobs?
I think this is where managing your expectations comes into the picture, because most of the jobs, I would say, whether it's retail or fast food joints or anything else, most of the places you will be earning the minimum wage, which is 12.80 currently again in Dublin. And that's in Dublin. If you're outside of Dublin, if you're in Cork or Galway, it will probably be cheaper. Lower. But there's a certain range, but you will be earning minimum wage, which is 12.80. But healthcare assistant jobs, it's 14. It's anything between 14 to 15, can even go up to 18 per hour. Door-to-door roles often pay 14.85 to 16 euro per hour. So again, very well-paying jobs. Security also, I think the minimum goes, like, it's pretty good. It's like 14 euro per hour is what I heard from my friends who are doing it. So yeah, fast food. But the only issue that I experience, so I also worked at McDonald's for 2 months. There are like famous outlets, like the outlets in Dublin would be like O'Connell Street, mm-hmm. Where a friend of mine works. So he has never had issues with hours, but I worked in the outlet in Santry, and I ended up getting like very few hours. Once I got 8 hours, mm-hmm. which is ridiculous because it wasn't enough to cover my rent at all. So that's the one problem I found with fast food joints. So that way, I think taking up security or healthcare assistant jobs are very helpful. And please remember, you can only work 20 hours legally. So you have to manage all of that. So take all of this into account when you look for your jobs.
So Nima, where can students look for these part-time jobs?
So I think the most common way that people do this is they literally carry like a few printouts of the CVs, mm-hmm. In some cases even cover letters, but then that's very specific because some jobs might ask for like specific cover letters. I think CVs is like a safer mm-hmm. option, and they literally go nearby. Like a lot of people go to city center, but please guys, like city center, everyone goes there, so there's very less chance of you actually finding a job there. So but yeah, taking your CV printouts and just distributing them, and people will usually, if they're interested, if they're hiring, they'll probably ask you to write the number of hours you're available for and probably your PPSN number in some cases, and that's it. Another very common, the way I found my jobs was looking for all options on jobs.ie. they have very good jobs. That's where I found my job with Oxfam. Another very popular site is Indeed. Indeed is very good for finding jobs as well, I find. So yeah, that would be it. And of course, when you just walk around, you know, if you're just roaming around in say places, when people are hiring, especially restaurants or bars, they'll just mention that we are looking for people. So just keep a watch, like, you know, watch out for these places and just see if they've put up ads.
And I'll also like to add that you can search for these jobs on the notice board in the universities as well, wherever you're studying. And so not so many jobs, if sometimes, for example, Primark or Penny's, which is called here, if they have an opening, they might not post it on Indeed or somewhere. So you might just check on their careers page and then you might find an opening. Same goes with McDonald's and Tesco's and chains like that.
Yeah, also, this is just a tip that when you're looking, there are a lot of, if you are fine with like babysitting or dog sitting, I think babysitting is like too much security issue, so I would probably avoid that personally. But there are a lot of apps where you, if you love animals, especially dogs, you can even dog sit and they're paying well. So, but that, for that, I think again, you will have to probably might have to get your Garda vetting done.
Yes.
And you will, yeah, but there also, that's also an option.
And they might, but that might not be like a fixed job.
Fixed job.
You might get it sometimes, you might get not.
Yeah.
So keep that in mind as
well.
So Nima, what tips would you like to share about CV and cover letter specifically for the part-time jobs?
First of all, this is especially for people who have experience. I'm assuming that, you know, your CV will be a bit long. It was in my case because I have like 3 years experience in a very irrelevant job, which is why I'm at that junction where I'm a fresher, but I'm also experienced. So please keep your CV short. We will also probably share like a template of what a CV would look like, because for a part-time job here, they don't want to see if you have excessive experience, because then they probably think you're overqualified for the jobs. So keep your CV very short. A lot of people lie on their CVs. Sometimes you can get away with it, but I am a terrible liar. I get very nervous, so I haven't lied yet. And I've gotten away with it.
I said that I worked in a cafe in India and it works.
Yeah.
Just write any popular cafe chain in India. Just write that in your CV.
Yeah.
Please.
Yeah, because chances are when you do find your job, they're just like, do you know this? And you can be like, no, you know, what I learned was a bit, the system was a bit different, so maybe you can teach me again.
Yeah.
But yeah, it probably works. I am a terrible liar. So at least in this case, I am. So yeah. But...
what about cover letters?
So you know, DCU, we had like a Launders on campus. So Launders, I remember I made my first cover letter for them. So big chains often ask for your cover letters, but not everyone does. But I would say just make like a standard. Like, let's say you're applying to Burger King and McDonald's and other like Domino's or something. Just make like a common cover letter that, oh, I'm so happy to be a part of this, as whatever.
You have the template, right?
I do have a template.
So we'll add the screenshot of both the CV and the cover letter.
Yeah, and on the CV, just, you know, start, I would say, first of all, give your basic information, like your name, of course, email ID, contact, but also, I know it's strange, but mention where you live, because for a lot of jobs, they want to see where, if, because in Dublin, you know, the buses are not on time most of the time.
So that's completely another topic.
Yeah, that's another topic, but a lot of workers want to see how easy, because if they are someone who need you to come immediately, if it's a job like that, then they need to see like how accessible the workplace is for the person, so they want to see the address. So yeah, you should mention, at least if you don't want to give the exact address, but just, you know, kind of mention where you live, the area you live in. And yeah, again, just keep it brief, but then, again, very important is that if you're looking for jobs, whether it's a barista job or like a retail job or anything, make sure that the words that are used in the ads that you see are used in your cover, in your CV. Okay, like if they're saying excellent communication skills, so mention that, you know, you're proficient in, or let's say they ask for proficiency in MSA Office. So, use the exact words that are used in the ads, because that's a very good way of getting past the AI and the initial screening. Because a lot of times, the problem is that our CVs don't even reach the hirers because they just get rejected in the very first stage. So, just, you know, edit your CV accordingly.
Yeah, match the keywords from the job description to your CV.
All the annoying buzzwords, you have to be a bit pretentious in your CV and you have to add them.
Now, Nima, what are some interview tips that you would like to share with our audience?
Okay. See, I'll be very honest. If you're going for like a simple fast food retail or retail job, then honestly, they're not asking you much. They'll just ask you, what's your schedule like in the university and how far you stay and everything. You just have to be very convincing that, oh, you know, I'm okay, I'm flexible.
Just these say are yes to
me. Yeah, and just say, like, I know it sounds like you're desperate, but well, you are a little bit. So you have to be. But there are some jobs that are a little bit more demanding, I would say. So, like, again, for my first job that I landed as a door-to-door fundraiser, I had a written interview as well. So I had to kind of, they gave me a question, like, think of this issue in Ethiopia. when there's a war going on and there's a serious water shortage and how I would address it. Of course, I was allowed to use the web, like the internet, but it was still kind of, yeah, you have to be prepared for certain jobs. You have to put in a little bit more work, but usually it's generally just be presentable and just be very friendly. And I think where a lot of people from, like we lack is our communication skills, be a bit, engage with them a little bit more so that they are like, okay, this person is not uncomfortable talking to people. Also, I think one of the jobs that I landed, which I couldn't take up, unfortunately, was a tele sales executive job at a pharmacy company because I was compelled to take an unpaid internship, which was compulsory for my course completion. But that interview lasted 1.5 hours. Wow. It would have paid me €16 per hour. And all I had to do was work thrice a week. But of course, I am not lucky. But that guy, literally, I'm not lying, he questioned me on every part of the CV. Like, it went back. So I started working 2018 and he asked me about that job. And honestly, even I didn't remember what I did. And he literally asked me about like my hobbies. Like, I wrote calligraphy and I did calligraphy for like 5 months when I was in probably 2022. And he asked me about that. Which is why I said that for certain jobs like these, especially, avoid lying on your CV because they will question you throughout. If you're just going for like barista or something, you can get away with it. But if you're going for specific jobs, avoid that.
So the questions depend on what kind of job you're applying. Basically, it can be very basic and it can go to an advanced level as well.
Yeah. So the number one thing is whatever you're writing in your CV, be very sure about it and be thorough with it. Even if you're just mentioning something you didn't exactly do, like let's say you're saying you worked at Cafe Coffee Day, make sure that you have an alibi or make sure something that you know what you're writing about, at least. Like, talk to other people who have worked as a barista maybe, so that at least you're convincing enough to lie about it is all I would say. Know your CV very well.
Great. Yeah. So Anima, what are some tips that you can share with the audience for balancing studies and work?
Not that I nailed this part myself. So I think first of all, it's very important to analyze what kind of jobs you can take up, you know, your capacity, because, you know, kind of first of all, understand, can you manage whatever you are intending to take up? If you come, if you are pursuing a very intensive course and let's say, like for my course, I remember in my first semester, I only had classes twice a week. So it was not very hard to do a job, like take up a part-time job. It was tiring, of course, because whichever course you do, there's a lot of studying to be doing in master's course. So please remember how many hours you can put in and you have to manage your other things. So first, understand your capacity. Like finance courses, I know they mostly have classes like 4 to 5 days a week, which means you are only left with 2 days. And honestly, if you have that, that's not very flexible. So it might be a little hard for you to find a job. But yeah, understand your capacity first before you just take up any job. And also remember, like, if you're someone who is used to working hard and just putting, by working hard, I mean, I'm not questioning your ethic, but like literally your capacity to put in the physical work, because, you know, working at like something like a McDonald's is very physically demanding. I would like, even like a 6 hour shift, I remember I would just come back and just like not even want to pick up my phone to answer people back. It can be that tiring. I mean, you get used to it eventually, but especially during the initial part, it's very tiring. Again, if something like a fundraising job or any other sales job, you're constantly on your feet for like, you're covering 30,000 steps a day almost, and you're talking to people. And you have to be friendly and nice, no matter how dead inside you feel. So emotionally, physically demanding jobs. So you have to remember the jobs you apply for, can you actually do them? And can you actually fit that into your schedule with your other classes and everything? So plan all of those ahead, because, you know, if you don't do well in your modules, the problem is, I understand a lot of people are taking up the master's course because they just want to enter the enter the country. But to be honest, guys, if you screw up your modules, it's going to be very difficult to find a job later on. So just kind of manage everything and don't. Just make sure that your part-time doesn't overtake your life. And you also remember that, you know, you also need some time to chill. It shouldn't be just like you're going to class and then you're doing your part-time and then you're just... Because those are the people who complain about the life in Ireland the most. Like, whenever I talk to people, they're like, oh, the life sucks. is because you're not enjoying life. You're literally just going to university and you're going to do your job and you're coming back.
Makes sense.
So yeah, just manage all of those and then do it.
So one thing that I would like to add that I used to do and I still do, that if there is something, for example, if I'm doing a course or there's a homework for you, in case like for the students, so and your commute is quite long, it might take you 1 hour to reach from your class to your work or wherever, so I would watch that video or do the reading in the bus or in the DART or whatever form of transportation that you are using. I would do that. And I think as a student, you might have to make some sacrifices. For example, you would be invited to a lot of parties and a lot of, you know, stuff with your friends. So you might have to sacrifice that, but just for a year while you are doing your masters, you can do all of that later. I'm not saying just completely stop it, but you might have to prioritize what is important for you and what you have to let go for the moment while you are doing your masters to manage the part-time job and your studies. Because if earning your expenses is your priority, then do keep that in mind, because I did that and I know a lot of people who did that, and I also know a lot of people who did not do that and they literally had to go back to India because they couldn't find work after their masters and also while they were doing so. Just keep that in mind as well. So Anima, what are some challenges that you faced in the whole process now that you have been here for over a year, and what are some tips that you would like to share with the students?
First of all, I think the 20-hour limit is really painful, to be honest. Like, I know, although it makes sense, because now that I think that a lot of courses, it's very hard if you start working for more than 20 hours a week. But I do know of people who do cash jobs and they'd work more than 20 hours. But working more than 20 hours can not only affect your studies, but it's also not, if the tax, you know, authorities get a hold of you, which is, to be honest, rare these days, but they can. So just be careful and like probably do not mess it up. But yeah, 20-hour challenges, 20-hour limit. Then also a lot of very good, there were jobs that I was eligible for, but they required expertise in a foreign language like Portuguese, right. Russian or German. German, I've seen, like, if you know German, they're like such good jobs here. So if you have a foreign language, if you have any expertise in foreign language, brush it up. I would say that's really helpful. But also a lot of people it's not like you don't know how to speak in English, but a lot of people are not very comfortable speaking to people. I would say, you know, just get over your inhibition, and, you know, no one is expecting you to go and give a speech. All they want you to do is just be comfortable speaking to people and just have a normal conversation, and please smile through your conversation when you, especially during your interviews, like, don't be too stoic and just scare hirers away. Because
Ireland, like, is a very friendly country, and they expect you to be friendly, especially in retail jobs. So show in the interview that you are a friendly person. Smile more.
Yeah, smile more. And just if they're speaking, like, how are you doing? Just say hi, you know. It's very weird for them to just... Yeah. I know Indians are like, we just keep to ourselves. And so Indians are like, oh, why are these people smiling a lot? Like, it's a normal thing. Like, it's a very human thing. They're smiling at you. Just smile back and say, hi, how are you? And, you know, these small things can happen. But yeah, language barriers, I've noticed... can be an issue for some people, so just get over that. Try to get over that, I mean. Also, I think other challenges, I think the main challenge was that this, I know it sounds like, especially if you're like a very young person who's coming as a 23-24 year old, it doesn't matter to you much, but mature students especially, you know, we don't pay attention to our health. We are eating garbage, because I have eaten garbage in the last 3 weeks, because I had like a very long week, working week. So try to plan, you know, things. Try to make sure that you get some amount of nutrition, you know. Just don't eat garbage and please sleep well, because I know this sounds stupid, but in the long run, it will affect how you work and how you study as well. And that the thing that like Sugandha also mentioned, that there will be times where you would want to go out and do most things, and you will see other people who have been probably working for a while or who have some financial support from home. They are having more fun than you and you are missing out. Just, it's fine. I know it doesn't feel good, but trust me, you will get a job eventually and you will be able to afford all of this, and you will be able
and
to afford...
And much more.
And much more, yeah. You will be like traveling with your friends, other people you meet outside of your university. Your life will not end, you know, once your university life ends. Probably your life will get way better after that. So just just keep that all of that in mind, and whenever you feel left out, whenever you feel like I'm missing out on stuff, remember you will get time to go back and enjoy all of that. So yeah.
So Arnima, any final word of advice that you would like to give to students before we wrap up the video?
I think the final piece of advice to kind of sum up everything would be, like, first of all, I think especially coming from India, I understand we have a lot of hang-ups about the kind of jobs we should do. You know, we are not the ones who would take up like cleaning jobs,
yeah.
Or the idea of being like waiting on people is culturally a bit shocking to us, especially if we have, because a lot of people know, oh, I studied, I finished my degrees, why should I do this job?
Yeah.
So please understand that it would be very rare for you to find like some office-based roles or something, you know, mm-hmm. Even like a receptionist job is very hard to get. So be prepared to take up any job. And the very good thing about this place is, not just this place, I think the moment you step out of India, is that jobs are not looked down upon. It's not like if you tell someone, oh, I have a cleaning job,
yeah.
People are not going to judge you. They're like, oh, okay, hard work, you're earning money.
Mm-hmm.
They have a lot of respect for that. So don't let that stop you, you know. Just look, whichever job you get, especially this is for people who have like financial constraints at home, just leave all of this at home. And no matter what people say, even if there are people, especially back home, who try to look down upon you for that, please don't let that affect you, okay? Because any job that you get that helps you get through and manage your expenses is good enough. Of course, as I've mentioned, also understand your capacity when you take up your job. Make sure that your studies don't get too affected by it. Very important, please remember that sort of luck also plays a part in all this. You might be very lucky. As soon as you have your documents, you might just apply for a job and you get it in like a week. But you might just not, you know, even despite being very actively looking for jobs, it might take some time. It might take a month, 2 months, even 3 months. This is where since I've arrived here, I've worked for 4 months at Oxfam. Incredible job. I didn't want to leave, but I had to because my schedule changed at the university and they require you to come thrice a week. And after that, oh my God, I think my downfall began the day I quit because I couldn't get a job for about 3 months. I have seen times when I literally in my account, I had like €5 and that was nothing. So, believe me, it can take a lot of time, and I waited and waited and waited. And it feels bad, you know, like I was a lawyer back home. So after that, when you get rejected from H&M for retail jobs, you're like, oh my God, where am I going wrong? But you do. The people just find jobs easily and some people don't. I had to wait quite a bit. I've taken all kinds of jobs in between just to support myself. So please be persistent, be patient. If it's taking time, it's not going to take forever. You will find it. Just don't give up. But at the same time, I would say that keep this possibility in your head that it might take some time. So when you're planning budgeting, just, you know, kind of try, if possible, to kind of budget that, okay, what if I don't find a job in the next 3 months? So when you land initially in the first 3 months till you find a job, especially spend very carefully, because you have to account for the fact that you can be, you might not find work easily. So yeah, keep that in mind. And just take a work and don't look down upon anything, and be ready, be very well prepared, know your CV well, and talk to people, network, ask your friends where you can look for jobs, and I'm sure something will come up. But yeah, and also very importantly, whatever job you get, eventually, if you see other people are enjoying going out more, don't let that dishearten you if you can't afford it, because it's just the fact some people just get paid more and they will be able to afford a lot more activities in town than you can. Just be happy with what you found because you worked hard for it. So
And you'll be able to afford all those things one day. So.
Yeah.
So yeah, it doesn't matter. Yeah. Thank you so much for watching this video, and huge thanks to Arnima for sharing her insights and some really, really valuable advice. So if you found this video helpful, guys, please share it with your friends, give it a thumbs up, do subscribe to the channel, and also drop your questions in the comments, and all the best for your job search, and I'll see you guys in my next video. Bye.